In this video, we'll look at the characteristics of developed, developing, and emerging economies such as the BRICS. The focus will be on six key areas of comparison seen here. But before we begin, I'd like to clarify some definitions. The naming convention of developed and developing economies is increasingly unaccepted, and I would venture to say that in the future the syllabus will change to reflect the more accepted naming conventions of low income, lower middle income, upper middle income, and high income countries. With that disclaimer out of the way, let's look at what this syllabus is referring to. When you hear the term developed economies, you should think about countries with a high GDP per capita with a relatively high standard of living. Countries on this list include the United States, the United Kingdom, Norway, Sweden, and Singapore. Developing economies have low GDP per capita and a low standard of living. Many of these countries still struggle with absolute poverty and low HDI values. Included on this list are Afghanistan, Costa Rica, Guatemala, and the Ivory Coast. When you hear the classification of emerging economy, you should think of countries that are making rapid progress towards being more economically developed. They are experiencing high rates of economic growth, and some are transitioning from planned to market economies. Included on this list are the BRICS, including Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, and the MINT economies, Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. Emerging economies still face development issues, but many are making significant progress in tackling them. The first area we'll examine is population growth and structure. It is very important to remember that the following descriptions are not one size fits all, and that trying to briefly explain the characteristics relevant to the types of economies will only provide a general picture of what the typical economy in that category is experiencing. The population of developed economies tends to be growing slowly. This is in large part due to couples having fewer children than before. In the US, the ratio of children born per woman is 1.87. The population is said to be aging, meaning the median age in a country is rising due to longer life expectancy and lower fertility rates. By comparison, developing economies tend to experience high population growth, partly due to lack of education for girls and women. Greater access to education could result in increased awareness of family planning, as well as increased productivity for women, thus creating an incentive to remain in the workplace. In contrast to the United States, Afghanistan has 5.12 children born per woman. The emerging economies typically experience rapidly growing populations, with the exception of China due to the one-child policy, which has only been changed in recent years to address the problem. India's children born per woman ratio has fallen to 2.22 in 2018 from 5.9 in 1960. Next up is the distribution of income. For developed economies, it is argued that there is typically a more equal distribution of income than you would find in less developed economies. While income inequality still exists, it is to a lesser degree than seen in developing economies. The Gini index in Iceland in 2015 was approximately 26.8. Developing economies suffer from high levels of income inequality due to the vast disparities between the owners of the factors of production and labor. To compare against Iceland, Honduras had a Gini index of 52.1 in 2018. In the emerging economies, incomes tend to rise rapidly, with some inequality still prevalent. China's Gini index was approximately 38.5 in 2016 by comparison. Third is the economic structure of industry. Developed economies typically have a dominant tertiary or service sector. Their secondary sectors are relatively small by comparison. The supporting statistics are from the CIA World Factbook as of 2017. In the EU, for example, the secondary sector accounts for approximately 25% of GDP. The primary sector within the EU is less than 2% of GDP. Developing economies typically have larger primary and secondary sectors. Burma's primary sector accounted for roughly 24% of its GDP in 2017, whereas the secondary sector contributed approximately 36%. The service sector was not small by any measure, at about 40% of GDP. The emerging economies usually have rapidly growing secondary and tertiary sectors. China's economy in 2017 consisted of about 52% of activity from services, and 40.5% for manufacturing. The agricultural sector seemed very small by comparison, contributing about 8% to GDP. China has been aiming to develop domestic consumption and move away from the export-led growth that has brought it thus far. Using that same information, we can draw some conclusions about the employment composition in these same categories of economies. It follows that the largest employment sector is the tertiary sector in developed economies, while still having a significant high-quality industrial employment base. Developing economies will typically have most of their employment within the primary and secondary sectors. Chad, in North Central Africa, has 52.3% of its GDP from the primary sector and another 14.7% in the secondary sector. For the emerging economies, the service sector is by far the largest employment sector of the economy, and it's growing. For all of the BRICS economies, this holds true. The nature of external trade will vary as well. Developed economies typically have strong consumer demand, and thus will be less dependent on exports to sustain their economies. This could also lead to higher imports of manufactured goods and raw materials. Developing economies draw their strength from exporting goods produced in the primary and secondary sector. This may result in them being dependent on export markets to sustain their economies, which leaves them susceptible to changes in global trading patterns. Emerging economies have built their countries on strong exports within the primary and secondary sector. They may still have strong export industries, but are growing their abilities to export services as well. Beyond this, they will have high demand for capital as they continue to develop their productive potential. Finally, we'll look at urbanization, or the movement of citizens to cities. For developed economies, the effects of urbanization have slowed somewhat. Many more workers are leaving the cities to live outside for quality of life reasons. In developing economies, workers are attracted by the growth opportunities offered in the cities and will leave behind rural areas to seek out employment. This is driving a lot of migration to cities, however, there are still significant percentages in rural areas. For the BRICS and other emerging economies, urbanization is happening rapidly. In China, many are leaving their rural homes for the abundant opportunity available in the cities. There are jobs available in construction, food, retail, and many other sectors that attract low-skilled labor to cities. To do this topic justice would take far more than the amount of time I've dedicated to this video. For further reading, check out the references included in the video description. Beyond this, please visit the website of my good friend and colleague Steve Heath, who operates the Geographer Online. He was very supportive in gathering information for this video, and I've included a link to his website below as well. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below and let's try and answer them together. That's us done for now, and I will see you in the next one.